messed up the things that are important, so I thought that I used to do this all the time, haven't followed. We were talking about that this morning. I think that most pastors don't do that anymore. It's tend to be a bit casual, but this is important. So let's join together in our call to worship. I invite you to stand as we read responsively. This is a great and joyous festival day. Come to celebrate amazing good news.
We gather for worship in awe and wonder. The tomb is empty. Death is not the last word.
Sing songs of praise, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever.
God has answered our prayers with salvation. Jesus Christ is alive, and we too shall live.
Open your hearts and minds to the risen Christ. You are greeted by name and welcome here.
This is the day that our God has made, and in which God made all things new. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Let's join together in our opening prayer.
We greet the dawning brightness of this great and glorious day with hopes renewed. We have known grief and sorrow, loss and tears, fear and failure. Lead us here within our eyes, for
that we'd like to lift up to the congregation as well to God?
Just a way to have our wish for you. Makes the singing sound so much better.
My talking would sound better if I put the mic back on too. I take that off so that you can't hear me singing.
Thank you.
Well, I tell you what I tell other people. You can't be good looking, intelligent, have a great personality, and sing. You have to give up one of those. We are grateful for all those here. Yeah.
I'd like to tell you how much we appreciate Debbie doing the Sunday morning services for all of us that are at home. We really do appreciate it.
Yes, the live stream has been a great hit, I think, because we've had a lot more people watching than we even anticipated. Probably several of them watching this morning.
Yes.
So we thank you for watching. But we're grateful for technology and for those who understand it enough to use it.
I'm too
old. But we're grateful. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Any others?
On the 24th, we'll have our annual meeting at Colonnade. Everyone is welcome to come.
Yeah, I think that's the Cemetery Association.
Yes.
The 24th.
And lunch is at noon.
The best thing about it is they feed you.
Everybody needs a dish.
We need prayers for Jerome. He's had a little setback, but we hope he's going to recover.
Now, Jerome is not feeling so well today, so we'll lift him up in prayer. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Anybody else? Let's take a moment and put ourselves into the presence of God. Lord God, today is beyond our understanding. Raising your Son from the dead is so beyond our experience. Our reason says no, but our faith says yes. Take us to the empty tomb. Let us see the stone rolled away. Give us a vision of angels. We want to know who we're looking for. Let Jesus stand before us, calling our name. Shake our world so that we can see and believe. Tell us once more to go in your name. To tell people that Jesus is not dead, but still among us. Jesus is calling their name. Christ is risen, and the world is different. We stand in his presence and pray in his name. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Let's hear from the book of Acts about the history of in the church.
Our scripture reading today is from Acts 10, verses 34 through 43.
when the Gentiles hear the good news. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he gave to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, and how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. Yes. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And our psalm today is 118. It's on page 839 in the back of your hymnal.
We'll use a different response. The words are just, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Those are the words.
Stand as we sing. Hear this word from the Gospel of John. Early on the first day of the week, when it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went towards the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. And then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrapped lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrapping, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scriptures, that he might rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white sitting at the where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the foot. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascended to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Anybody here ever hear of George Washington? What about Bill Gates? Did you ever hear that name before? How about Muhammad Ali? You ever hear that name? How about Demosthenes Odom? The first ones were famous for something. They were well known by a lot of people. D, as we call them, was not famous. He was my friend and co-worker in the church in Austin. He used to take care of the buildings and the people. He was never on TV. He was never in the paper. He was important to that small group that knew him. Therefore, he was important to the kingdom of God. And he was important to God. God knew his name. He died a few years ago, and I imagine God called him by name. Jesus said, "The shepherd knows his sheep by name. And he calls them, and they know his voice, Jesus knew the name of people. He knew the names of people who the world did not care much about and didn't pay much attention. The world did not know their names, like blind Bartimaeus and the beggar Lazarus and Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene was possessed, and Jesus freed her, healed her, liberated her from her demons. He knew her name. She would have been forgotten, except that Jesus knew her, and therefore we know her from Scripture. That's going to be important in the resurrection. We spent the week going through the Holy Week. It's the biggest part of the gospel message. Some of the theologians have said that all the gospel is a story of the last week of Jesus with a big preamble. We come up to Maundy Thursday and eat supper with him. We go to the cross with him on Friday. And now it's Easter Sunday morning. The other gospels say that the women went to the tomb. John's only interested in Mary. We don't know why she's going. It doesn't say in John that they're preparing the body. All we know is that she decides to go to the cemetery. I like to think that she's not through grieving. Kind of like we go to the cemetery to get our mind wrapped around that we lost somebody we love. She wasn't finished grieving. And John says she went in the dark. Now that's important for the Gospel of John, because John makes a big deal of Jesus being the light and other people being in darkness, loving darkness. He makes a big deal of blind, making blind people to see, while the people who can see, who should be able to know what God is doing, are blind. Jesus is the light of the world. Mary didn't know yet. She was in the dark. She goes and sees the tomb and the stone rolled away. That's the first hint that God is doing something. Because we talked about this morning, that's a large stone that gets put in front of the, it's about 6 feet tall and about 1 to 2 feet thick, and so it rolls down into place. The reason is to keep grave robbers out of the tomb, and it takes two or three or more people to roll it back up to get it out of the way to get in. And so it was rolled up and no one's around. God is doing something. She doesn't know what to do. She's confused. She's a very practical person. She goes to see to John and Peter and says, I don't know what happened. They must have done something. And so John and Peter have the most ridiculous race in the Bible. I can't imagine two men in robes running. And it turns out to be a race. And John has something about one comes there and the other one goes in and the other one. I have a hunch that there was a tradition about who went into the tomb first. And instead of trying to pick between the two, John just said, let's just put them both there. And we'll call it a tie. They go in and they see that something's happened, that there's no grave robber, because the cloth is laid out and no grave robber would leave the cloth. And the head bandage is laid separate, rolled up. Nobody takes that much time. They don't know what in the world is going on. Should have. Jesus told them. So they were in the dark as well. The gospel says that John believed. We don't know what he believed. He said he didn't understand the scriptures yet, but he believed maybe the body was gone or that God was doing something. He didn't know yet, and so he goes home. When you're confused, you go home where things make sense. But Mary stays. And she looks in. And she sees an angel. Now, a lot of questions occur to me that I would have asked that angel, none of which occur to Mary. I would ask, who are you? Where did you come from? What's going on? But she is still fixated on where the body is. She says, where did you take Jesus? You see, I think that Mary is a very practical person. She knows that when you're dead, you're dead. And people that are dead don't walk away. She still wants to know where the body is. But she should have known from reading scripture that God is not practical. God does some of the most outrageous things you could ever imagine. He gives babies to old people and to virgins. He takes perfectly contented people and turns them into prophets where they have to speak the truth to power. He takes outcasts and rascals and makes them the means by which a new future is created. He has his son born in a barn. God is not limited by practicality. He's not really limited by our logic. He's not limited by our physical limitations. He's not limited by our thinking. God is impractical. She doesn't get an answer from the angel. She turns around and she's face to face with Jesus. But she doesn't recognize him. There's lots of theories. Maybe he had a spiritual body. Maybe because they didn't expect him to be standing up. Maybe all sorts of things. But I have a very practical solution for that. When Jesus went out of the tomb, he left the funeral wrappings in the tomb. He was not exactly dressed for success. I imagine there was a gardener's cottage nearby, and that gardener had washed his clothes and put them out on the line. And Jesus said, I'm going to need that. And that's why she didn't recognize him, because he had another man's clothes, indicating another job. Then Jesus says, Mary. And that's all she needs to hear. She is one of his sheep. She recognizes his voice. The relationship is renewed. She knows that Jesus is raised from the dead. Jesus says, go tell somebody. Go tell the disciples that I am risen. See, we're practical people too. We think that when you're dead, you're dead. Resurrection, well, that's kind of iffy. But it's not the empty tomb that convinces us. It's not the witness of other people who say it happened. It's because he calls our name. He knows us. And we recognize his voice. That's the reason we believe in resurrection. Because on Easter Sunday morning, Jesus is calling your name. And you know it's him. And you know it's Paul. And then he gives us something to do. He said, go tell somebody, or better yet, show somebody. And you know what the best way of telling somebody or showing somebody is? To know their name. The people that the world would forget, the people who are not noticed, God knows their name. And so can we. And in knowing the name, they can hear Christ speak to them. Christ is risen. How do we know? Because he spoke our name to us this morning. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we respond to God's presence, God resurrecting his Son on this great morning of new life, let us affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed, number 881. Let us stand so we show the world what we stand for. I believe in
God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
And seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Join with me.
Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Take a moment and take your individual petitions. Here's the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love towards us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Join join me in the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with all your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and upon these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Just as Jesus lifted up the bread, so do we, because we want to eat with him. We break the bread so that we can partake of it, but also to remember his brokenness for our sake. We yet lift up the cup and ask God's blessing upon it, that it might become for us a source of healing and wholeness, a source of forgiveness, a cup of life. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, who came and showed us the words of truth and the power of miracles. He embodied you in the world, and even more than that, he went humbly to this death on the cross for our sake. And then on this Sabbath morning, our Sabbath, he raised up from the dead to say that death does not have the final victory, that evil and sin will not win, that your kingdom is on the way. May this kingdom feast be a foretaste of the feast that Jesus has prepared for us in the kingdom of God. Amen. Will those assisting please come and help and receive?
Thank you.
table's prepared. We're going to have a party, a resurrection party, and you have been invited. Please come. Closing hymn this morning is "Up from the Grave He Arose," number 322. We invite you to stand as we sing.
Thank you.
of love. We have seen the risen Christ, and we are changed. Let's sing our benediction.
Go out and greet him in the highways and byways.